express my deepest gratitude for any of you who've been brave enough to stick around for this talk. So really, what's it all about? And that basically comes down to reproducibility, and that's the principle of scientific method. As you all know, science is dependent on measurement, and I don't think anybody here does breast implants without doing some preoperative measurements. So what's costing? What's costing you is patients who throw up, patients who are in pain, and patients who take too long to wake up. And what's the big deal about Goldilocks anesthesia? Well, there's the lowest published rate of nausea and vomiting, there's minimal pain, and they wake up very nicely. So the problem with postoperative nausea and vomiting prevention and treatment is that it can be expensive and not terribly effective. And here's why it's not terribly effective. As long as you're giving narcotics and stinky gases like CFO, DES, and isoflurane, you're throwing a match in the gasoline. And it's especially bad for our patients who are non-smoking females having cosmetic surgery and frequently with histories of nausea and vomiting and previous surgery, as well as motion sickness. So what happens when you stop giving drugs that make people sick to their stomach is that you get the lowest published rate of postoperative nausea and vomiting in the literature in high-risk patients without the use of Zofran, Enmed, and that sort of thing. Hopefully that concept is very easy for all of us to grasp. Don't throw the match in the gasoline, and you do not need the fire extinguisher. Okay, so the preemptive anesthesia principle is very, very simple. The brain can't respond to information it doesn't get. And the problem for me is in the first 15 years I gave anesthesia as a classically trained anesthesiologist, it never once crossed my mind. Why did I have to give narcotics to patients for pain after surgery? Well, of course, surgery's painful. Well, once I saw the first 50 patients of this technique wake up not in dire need of a narcotic pain relief, maybe Tylenol or Toradol, and not being sick to their stomach, I said, gee, Eureka, I've got it. So what happens when you preempt pain? Well, you have to have adequate local analgesia, and that's the key to the technique. And over the last 18 years, in the more than 4,000 patients, fewer than 5% required very modest fentanyl doses post-op, 25 to 100 mics per kilo, and not per kilo, 25 to 100 mics, period. And even those patients were extremely happy. This year is now the 20th year since the FDA approved the BIS brain monitor. You'll see the cover of my 2007 textbook, which is now in three languages, Portuguese and last year Mandarin Chinese. And you will see the BIS monitor is right there. And if you look carefully, you'll notice that there's two waveforms. Well, this year, last year, 2015, the company finally relented and put this real-time signal. The lower trace is essentially the EKG of the frontalis muscle. And before you ask, even ladies with Botox generate enough. It's an infinitesimal signal. It's useful. So Goldilocks anesthesia is very simply brain-monitored propofol ketamine. It is numerically reproducible. It's a directly measured cortical effect. Here are the numbers, very simply. Awake, 98 to 100. Sedation, moderate to deep, 60 to 78. General anesthesia, 45 to 60. And most importantly, you're way over medicated for 45. I would point out that I've done well over 800 abdominoplasties, carrying the patients in 60 to 78 without need for intubation. In fact, only 5% of patients wind up needing as much support as an LMA. So our brain monitor is our best available technology. Why do patients take too long to wake up? You're failing to measure the organ that you're medicating. This simply shows you that propofol and those halogenated agents, the stinky gases, act on the cortex, but your vital signs, which I grew up with, only measure the brainstem. We're not trying to medicate the brainstem. They're important because without vital signs, you're not vital. So this is why anesthesia over medication is routine, as well as dangerous. Body weight, heart rate, and blood pressure are simply the wrong thing. So would your anesthesia provider give blood pressure meds like labetalol or hydralazine and not measure the blood pressure? But of course, cannot be serious, right? So why would your anesthesiologist, nurse anesthetist, give a brain medication and not measure, directly measure the brain response? Okay, the reality of life is the drugs we're giving are designed to medicate the cortex. And without measurement, you're doing no better than the guy at the carnival who guesses the weight. it's a guessing game. And I'm a really good guesser, but given a choice that I've been doing for the last 18 years, I vastly prefer measurement, because measurement leads to reproducibility. The bispectral index is a cortical monitor. As an index, it has no units. I'll remind you again that I have no financial connection to the company. So why is this wonderful monitor not used more often? On the left-hand side, you see the original factory default, 7. And that's about as useful as trying to use your rearview mirror to drive your car, okay? So as I said before, the EMG is the frontalis muscle, and like the EKG is for the cardiogram. This is the new factory default setting as of 2015, and we all know how difficult it is to change things, so at least 7 years ago, 8 years ago now, 9 years, this is from the cover of my textbook, and this is like looking through the front windshield when you're trying to drive your car. It's very useful and dramatically changes the conduct of anesthesia. People always ask me, well, gosh, you know, how can you do a facelift or an endobrow lift with the darn thing on the forehead? Well, first, it's not a sterile procedure, but if you're interested in trying to be as clean as possible, you dab the sensor. The gentleman on the right pictured with me is Dr. Nikanor Issei, one of the three gentlemen credited with endobrow lift development. He and I did 5 years worth of facelifts and endobrow lifts using the BIS monitor without a problem. What happens? Well, you get a statistically significant 30% numerically reproducible decrease in your drug costs. And I published that 16 years ago. And what happens when people stop throwing up is you decrease the time to discharge and dramatically increase your cost effectiveness. These are the 9 words that summarize the last 18 years of my life's work. Measure the brain, preempt the pain, medic drugs abstain. Over these years, I've averaged 25 to 50 mics per kilo per minute of propofol to keep the BIS in the range that you see there, this range here. And every time the red goes up, the white goes in. This spike is the patient's way of saying, I'm about to wake up if you don't do something. So over the years, we've had a 60-fold variation, seen 60-fold variations. So outliers really matter, okay? So the first patient who told me that she slept for 2 days when she got propofol, apparently the fragile sticker affixed to this box meant absolutely nothing to you. That was my first video clip. I'm going to spare you video clips unless we have some room at the end. This is my little Venezuelan or Colombian party girl, and you don't want to try to drink this 110-pound woman under the table. So routine over-medication is a natural consequence of cortical measure failure. You're wasting drugs, you're prolonging wake-up time, you extend your discharge time. It's an exceedingly uneconomical way to give anesthesia. Safety has come a long way in anesthesia. We lost more people in anesthesia death in the 1950s than we lost polio, but not dying was the 20th century anesthesia standard. Waking up with all your brain cells, your marbles, is the 21st century standard. That, by the way, is the goal of my nonprofit Goldilocks Foundation, to make routine brain monitoring routine. What happens? Without the brain monitor, 40% of patients wake up in some degree of brain fog. Before we had the brain monitor, our sleep dose, our initial dose, was dependent on body weight. And the problem was, for fear of giving too little, we always had to give too much. And I'd like to point out that nobody dies from anesthesia under medication, anesthesia awareness. But one patient a day dies from anesthesia over medication. And that was published in 2009. So measuring is clearly better than guessing. Thank you, Captain Obvious. One over-medication death every day, as I said, published now 7 years ago. The article is not deemed an article of significant interest. So, as I said before, this is what I published last year in the British Journal of Anesthesia. Clearly, measuring the organ that you're medicating should be a no-brainer. Real-time BIS is really BIS EMG. And so, as I said before, when the red goes up, the propofol, the white goes in, and the gain for the anesthesia provider is to give more propofol to get the EMG, the red, back to the baseline. So what's the deal about Goldilocks anesthesia? It's a numerically reproducible paradigm. It's safer, simpler, and much more importantly, it's cost-effective, more cost-effective. So again, we go over the triad, measure the brain with this EMG, preempt the pain is the nifty-50, 50 milligrams of IV ketamine. That's independent of adult body weight. 3 minutes before you stimulate, emetic drugs abstain, no opioids or stinky gases. The advantage of incremental induction, and you can see this on YouTube going under with Goldilocks anesthesia, you maintain the airway, you decrease your outliers, you avoid ketamine hallucinations because you create a stable level in the brain of propofol. Preempting the pain, as I just said, 50 milligrams, it's a non-opioid preemptive technique. You do not need ketamine during the case unless you are injecting virgin fields. And not opioid preemptive analgesia, it fails if you don't achieve 98 to 99% walk. The outcome, as I said earlier, less than 5% of patients require modest post-op fentanyl, and these are patients with subpectoral breast swells and classical abdominoplasty. They typically go home in less than an hour. So without the brain monitor, anesthesia over medication is a routine practice. Again, I remind you, one a day dies in the United States. And we ask ourselves, was Andy Rooney, who was 92 when he went to the hospital for a routine minor surgery, never got out? Was he a victim of anesthesia over medication? Also, Clint wants to know if you feel lucky. So people say, that's a nice talk, Dr. Freeberg, but are you alone in your opinion? And I will tell you that I am no longer alone, that the folks at Emory University say, this is a cost-effective way to give anesthesia. I think it's pretty self-evident. I want to thank you all for your attention. You can always reach me at Dr. Barry at Goldilocks Anesthesia Foundation.
Here is that the red area, EMG, will start to decrease before the yellow, the bismonitor. And here's Dr. Lynn.
Yeah. I didn't realize you're so tall.
Yeah.
Especially when I'm standing.
Come on, new person, right? Yeah. Pigs, I'm going right now. I feel it.
Hopefully it feels pleasant.
It feels pleasant. Mm-hmm. It's like my ideal way to die, but I mean.
Well, we tend not to do that.
And I'm like 106, you know?
Yeah.
I want my dog by my side, though.
Mm-hmm.
What kind do you have? A Roddy. Well, I have my daughter's too, but. All right, here we go.
So this young lady is a nice young lady.
Will I be twitching?
No twitching.
I might be gassy because I didn't eat, but.
Yeah, that's okay. We don't charge extra for gassiness.
And I'm feeling a little drunk.
Mm-hmm. It's pleasant though, isn't it?
It's a drunk feeling.
Yeah.
So I might say, I'm sorry staff, but I might mm-hmm. say shit that I don't.
Yeah, you would say.
Just don't worry, you know, I haven't had food since 10, so.
Yes, fortunately this little video doesn't have audio in it, it's just video, so.
Please don't mind my dry mouth.
It's okay.
This is a nice feeling.
Isn't that nice? Now you know why everybody likes Dr. Freeberg.
And when I get home, can I eat?
Yes.
Immediately. Okay, but I made some good porridge.
Mm-hmm.
If I wake up and marry an anesthesiologist,
mm-hmm.
I can eat, right? How many chances to the
mm-hmm.
How many put your arm right here. I spend
okay.
I got both. I got her and I got the biz in the frame.
Super. Perfect. That's great. You can stop now.